want to talk to you this morning about a different kind of worship. A different kind of worship. And that we find a different kind of worship taking place in Revelation chapter 5. And what happens at this place of Revelation chapter 5 is that the Christians in chapter 4 have been raptured from the world. And this is a scene in heaven. Verse number 8 says this, and when he had taken the scroll, that's Jesus. Okay, when Jesus had taken the scroll, the four living creatures and the 24 elders, they fell down before the Lamb, Jesus. Each was holding a harp and a golden bowl full of incense, which are the prayers of our saints. And it was at that time they sang a new song, saying, worthy are you to take the scroll and to open its seals, for you were slain by your blood and you ransomed people for God. And you ransomed every tribe, language, and people and nation. And you have made them kingdoms and priests to our God. And they shall reign on earth. And then I looked and I heard around the throne the living creatures and the elders and the voice of the many angels numbering myriads and myriads and thousands saying with a loud voice, worthy is Jesus, who was slain to receive power, wealth, wisdom, might, honor, glory, and blessing. And I heard every creature in heaven, on the earth, and under the earth, and in the sea, and all that is in them saying, to him, to Jesus, who sits on the throne, to the Lamb, be blessings and honor and glory and might forever and ever. And the four living creatures, they just said amen. And they fell down and they worship him. God, we thank you for this moment and time. God, we thank you for the microscope that we get to open your book, the book of destiny. And with this microscope, we are able to peer in to heaven and see a scene that will take place in a day to come. And God, that's why we're here today. And we're saying thank you in advance. Because we're not looking at the things we see. We're looking at the things that will be. And God, we say thank you for this, our study time. In Jesus' name we do pray. Amen. As we were saying, this particular section of Scripture is a vision of the throne of Jesus, of God, we'll say, in the latter days or the days to come. The scene is actually about the one who sits on the throne. It's about him. It's about the living beings, the elders, myriads of angels, but the main figure, the starring actor, that we might say, is the Lamb. And the Lamb is Jesus, who was slain for us. He is the one that's in this group that eclipses and exceeds everybody else that's there. And when the Lamb of Jesus takes the sealed scroll, all of heaven erupts with praise. And they fall down on their knees and worship him. Why? Is it because he alone is worthy of the praise as well? At that moment in time, it becomes a different kind of worship. It becomes because they realize that Jesus Christ has redeemed man from the corruptness of the world, the corruptness of sin, and he has established us for the purpose that we were created for, that is to be with God. Now, we're talking praise and we're talking worship. Now, understand there is a difference between praise and worship. And I know some of you think that they are somewhat interchangeable, but they're really two different things. Now, here it is. Praise is a joyful recounting of all God has done for us. That's what praise is, okay? And it is closely intertwined with thanksgiving because we are appreciative of what God has done for us in our life, how he has worked on our behalf. Praise is universal, and it actually can be applied to any relationship. You can praise your family. You can praise your friends, your boss, postman, postwoman, or whatever it is. But praise really does not require anything of us, because we're just merely acknowledging a truthful act of righteousness that somebody has contributed on our behalf, if we will say, or they have contributed one to another. But now, you know, maybe some righteous deed. But since God has done many righteous deeds, you think he's worthy of the praise? I say so. He definitely is. But then there's worship. Worship comes from a different place. Comes from a different place in our spirit. You know why? Because worship is reserved for God alone. For the Bible tells us that we should worship God and only him. Now, understand, I didn't say praise. We should worship God, okay? And the art of worship is self-adoration for God. Praise can be a part of worship, but worship goes beyond praise. Praise is easy, but worship is not. Worship gets to the heart of who we really are in life. True worship, first of all, we have to get past self-worship and people worship and thing worship all around us. We must be willing to humble ourselves before God and surrender each and every part of our life to his control and his adoration in life. Worship is a lifestyle, not just an occasional activity, something that we do now and then, but that we do it all the time. You remember in John when Jesus Christ dealt with the woman at the well, and he explained this very topic to her about worship. He says in John 4:23 these words, "But the hour is coming, and now is, or is now here, if we'll say it like that, when the true worshipers will worship the Father in spirit and in truth." Listen, for the Father is seeking after such people to worship him. God is looking for worshipers in this world. Can he find any worshipers at Pine Grove this morning? Can he find any worship around your neighborhood? Can he find some worshipers on your job? You see, this is one of the things that we understand. So when we look at this passage of scripture, and we see verses 8 through 14, Why is it? It tells us why we ought to praise God. Why we ought to praise, why we ought to worship God. Praise and worship is what it tells us. The first thing is simply this. It's because God has all of our prayers. Did you ever really realize that God has all of our prayers as well? It says in verse number 8, "And when he," Jesus, "had taken the scroll, the four living creatures and the 24 elders, they fell down before the Lamb, each holding a harp," and watch this, "a golden bowl full of incense, which are the prayers of the saints." Did you not realize that the prayers that you have prayed, no matter how distressed you were, there was a sweet-smelling aroma to the nose of God? See, down here on earth, your prayers don't mean very much, and they're not considered of a whole lot of importance if you pray them before the state house or the Capitol House or whatever. They don't mean so very much. But we find in this passage of scripture that when we pray, our prayers are precious to the Almighty God. And each prayer that we pray, they are ushered, they're held in a bowl, and they are ushered in to his presence as well. You remember a long time ago, a lot of churches would have prayer meetings. We stopped having prayer meetings. You know why we stopped having prayer meetings? Because of the attendance being so low. Is that right? So we don't have prayer meetings anymore. But I wonder, did we realize, even with our low attendance, that God was there? He was in attendance to the prayer meeting himself. When we stop and think about it, singing and prayers, they've all been an integral part of Christian worship, both public and private. Whether you have a scratchy voice or you sing off key or not, Almighty God receives it as a different kind of worship. And all these prayers are poured out because we are asking Jesus to come back and fix any and everything that's wrong in this world. We want him to come back. That's what it is. Our problem that I have, come back and fix it. You know, and a way that we say it is like this. We say, thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. We were saying, it's a praise party going on in heaven. Make a praise party going on here as earth. And John 4:32 says this, and God is seeking or looking for those kind of people. You know why? Because he recognizes the fact that he's worth, that he is worthy. Who can but God count the volumes and the oceans in this world? Who can but God count the sands, the grains of sand on a seashore? Who but God can count the hairs on your head? We recognize that of our God. But guess what? That same God, he has not forgotten your prayers. None of them have ever been off. They've all been treasured in a golden bowl, according to that verse. And here's what you need to understand. The first day that you prayed, God heard you. Thank him in advance for what it is that you have already prayed, because it's an act of faith. Thank God every morning as soon as your feet hit the floor, because it's somebody that did not get up that day. When you get up, could you just thank him, because you really realize that this day something good is going to happen to you this day. And listen, not only is something good going to happen to you this day, something good is going to happen through you this day. Because God didn't bless you to keep that blessing to yourself. We were blessed to be a blessing, so we must understand that. So we can praise God or we can worship God because he has all of our prayers. But the second thing that we see in verse number 9 is that he has redeemed and delivered us with his blood. That's Jesus Christ, with the blood of Jesus Christ. Once the book of destiny is taken, those in heaven begin to pray, pay adoration to the one that is worthy. And here's what verse 9 said, and they sang a new song, saying, worthy are you, meaning Jesus, to take the scroll, that is the book of destiny, and to open the seals. For you were slain by your blood. You ransomed people of God from every tribe, and that's so very important, every language and people under the nation. This is a picture of salvation. Salvation is a picture of ransom, a ransom being paid for your freedom as well. And so what we find out is by his blood, Jesus Christ paid the price to ransom you, to make you a possession for God, so that you are no longer in the bondage of sin and death from the evil suffering in this plagued world that we live in as well. Said, sing a new song. Do you realize the theme preparing us to sing a different song, or preparing us for a day of worship, is repetitive throughout Scripture? Because at this time, it's as if we are saying old things pass away and all things become new. It says that the 24 elders lifted a new song. But they did so because it had been prophesied that they would do so. In Psalm 33:3, it said, sing to him a new song. In Psalm 40:3, it said, put a new song in my mouth. In Psalm 96:1, it says, oh, sing unto the Lord a new song. Psalm 98:1 says, oh, sing unto the Lord a new song, for he hath done marvelous things. Psalm 144, verse number 9 says, I will sing unto you a new song. Psalm 149, verse 1 says, praise the Lord, sing a new song to him as well. In Isaiah 42:10, for it says this, sing to the Lord a new song, praise him to the ends of the earth. We are prompt all through Scripture to be able to praise God for a new day. As in old things have passed away, behold, all things becomes new. But it's something else that I see. I think it's saying to us what we also hear, let the redeemed of the Lord say so in everything that you do by your actions everywhere. Because verse 9 goes on to say this, for you were slain by your blood, and you ransomed people to God from every language, every tribe, every people under the nation. When I look at that and I find out how black and brown and poor people are being persecuted and how they're being left out, and all that God created a system, he didn't leave anybody out. Is that he put in place a system that anybody at any time could have salvation. Anybody at any time could be ransomed. Anybody at any time could be redeemed as well. And then we find that if we can worship and praise God because he has all of our prayers and because he has ransomed and he has delivered us, then how should we praise? We look at the third thing in verse 12. For it says this, it was a praise of all of heaven. Praise of all of heaven. All of heaven fell down. Verse 12 says this, saying with a loud voice, worthy is the Lamb who was slain to receive power, wealth, wisdom, might, honor, glory, and blessings. He was worthy for all these things. In other words, Jesus Christ is worthy to receive all the wealth in the world. Jesus Christ is worthy to receive all wisdom in the world. Meaning when you come to a place in time when you got the right kind of wisdom, you know that Jesus Christ is real. We find out that Jesus Christ is worthy to receive all power. Jesus Christ is worthy of all strength and power as well. Because he never misuses power, never misuses strength in his life. He is worthy to receive honor. That's why we worship him. He is worthy to receive all glory. That's why we always say to God be the glory as well in our life. Right here, right him, we find out, give him the glory, give him honor, give him blessings. Why? Because he ransomed and redeemed our worthless souls in life. We find that he who is great has done great things in life. And they poured out in their worship on Jesus Christ. They worship him because he was able to open the book of destiny in life. Jesus Christ is not in control. No. Jesus Christ is in control. Satan is not in control. Jesus Christ is in control. The government is not in control. Jesus Christ is in control. Your boss man is not in control. You need to understand that very thought. But then I look at verse number 13. For it says these words. And then I heard every creature on earth, under the earth, in the sea, and all of them saying these words. To him who sits on the throne, to the Lamb be blessings, honor, glory and might forever and ever. And what do you say when there's nothing else to say? It's what they said in verse 14. Amen. And they fell down and worshiped him as well. And then as we come to a close, listen at a different kind of worship. You see, one of the things that we need to understand in life is that we worship him when the sun is shining. We worship him when the winds of troubles are blowing on us. We worship him when we do not see a silver lining. We worship him when the sun is not shining. We worship him when the clouds are hanging low in our life. Why do we worship him when all these things are going on in our life? Because worship will light up the clouds of sorrow. Worship will turn the gray skies into gold. Worship will give us a promise of tomorrow. That's hope for tomorrow. Worship will bring us a blessing manifold, meaning many times over. Worship him when the load is heavy. Worship him in a day when there is no comfort in your life. Worship him because your burdens will he carry. Somebody once called him a burden bearer in our life. Worship him because he will bear you up on the wings of an eagle. Worship him because God is seeking after those who will worship in spirit and in truth. Worship him because God delights in the praises of his people. Worship him and believe and trust in his holy word. Because the God we serve, he knows who trusts him. He knows. Because those who trust in God, they always worship him. And he knows that as well. So we say worship. It's when we surrender self-worship. When we surrender the worship of everything that's around us, it's when we surrender all.
I need you.
You need me.
You need me.
We're all a part.
We're all a part of God's body.
Stand with me.
Stand with
me. Look at somebody. Tell them agree with me.